You know, it's amazing because they always talking about the 90s, but remember, it definitely did start in the 80s.
He'll dunk this. It's Pierce from a long way out. And here's Dwayne Nielsen with a dunk.
Another guy, he comes to the basket. It's
comes across to Pierce, he puts it up. He misses Jones. He dunked it. Time up. It's all over. The 36 is home by 1 point. What a fantastic
The interesting thing about the history of the Adelaide 36ers is that they may well have been the Adelaide 36ers as the Adelaide City Eagles, because at the point of 1981 season, when that finished, Forestville couldn't continue in 1982, and at the last minute they withdrew, and rather than lose the second berth that South Australia had with West Adelaide, the Basketball Association gathered the other clubs together who volunteered to form a composite team, and then to show that they were not just a club team, it was the Adelaide City Eagles, which showed that it was representative of the rest of the state.
Biddings. Scores level!
Now the following year, when they had a bit more time to get organised, the chairman at the time, Dick Butler, came up with the name of the 36ers, which obviously relates to the founding of South Australia in 1836. And so that's when they were formally known by that name.
Down come Adelaide 36ers. Pierce is loose. Thank you very much, says Darryl Pierce.
But at that particular point, they weren't the only side representing South Australia. So they were the composite side that represented all the other club teams, and then there was the West Adelaide Bearcats.
Logan still, all the way, bang.
And at the end of 84, West Adelaide, who had gone by themselves for a long time, as West Adelaide in the local league as well as the NBL, really found it hard to compete financially.
It was like both teams were trying to feed off the same product, the same people, the same crowd, and we just couldn't separate the two parts. And West Adelaide and, you know, the 36ers is going, how can we make this work where we grab both parties, bring them together, and we'll get both crowds together, and then we can start making it happen.
When they merged the West Adelaide and the other group of clubs within South Australia, I thought it was a fantastic opportunity.
Ally again, the margin is two.
We're involved with a team that I thought potentially could be the best in Australia.
Westies had history. They had big history.
Absolute elation. The first ever national championship win to the West Adelaide Acacia Bearcats.
I felt bad for Westies as well, for one reason, because they had to swallow their pride, they had to swallow all their history, and it just, when amalgamated, I thought Westies should have got more out of the deal.
I think they wanted to retain their identity. There was even some talk of the new team being called the Bearcats to retain that connection.
If we talk about retiring uniforms, I felt that my uniform should have been retired through that situation if you would have counted the West Adelaide era, because, you know, you're talking about an MVP, you talk about top leading score, you're talking about all-star team, all that came into mix, but it wasn't up to me.
But I think wiser heads prevailed, and in the end, West Adelaide was quite happy to continue when they saw how big their representation was actually going to be in the team. People will scratch their heads and believe whichever, or take whichever starting point that they want. If you want it as South Australia's sole, only entrant in the NBL, it's 1985. In 1985, when the 36ers became one entity, West End immediately jumped on board as their major sponsor, and they were actually known as the West End 36ers.
You've got to be part of the team. This is no time to make mistakes. Can't afford to blow it. When you know you got just what it takes, you got to go for it. Show it, doing it right. West End.
You know, who knows, maybe today and all the rest of it, because I guess everybody is trying to promote wholesome living and all the rest of it. Maybe today that may not be as appropriate for basketball. So.
They were the most talented team. They were the most financial team. They had everything that the other teams wanted and aspired to be.
I mean, you had someone like Al who'd had a 71-point game early in his career, had averaged, you know, 39 in a season,
Al Green, when he first got here, was just amazing. We'd never seen anything like him. He was quicker than anybody. He was more skilled. He could shoot the ball from range. He could shoot the ball from mid-range. And he would get to the basket whenever he felt like it. He could throw down dunks.
I grew up in the South Bronx of New York and what we call the real ghetto. And I played with Moses Malone, Magic Johnson. He was a good friend of mine. Bernard King, that played with the New York Knicks, and we were roommates. I got drafted to the San Diego Chargers, and basically I never played football. But because I ran, and I was fairly strong back then, and you know had a good jump, they drafted me for a defensive back. My agent talked to them, we had a meeting, and they told me how much money was gonna pay me, everything, and I said, look, let me go away with this and think about it. Went away, slept on it, and I really just said, I'm not a football player. I love basketball. Somewhere in the world I can play.
Anyone that can play at that speed in basketball and win the Bay Sheffield twice and professional 400 meter races at the Adelaide Oval, I mean, he was an athlete I'd never seen before.
I was the bad guy. I was getting all the ladies. I was doing all this and all that. Okay. Nah, well, I'm only joking.
In 1984, which was the last year West Adelaide competed on in its own right, he averaged 39.5 points a game and threw down 71 points in a game, which was just an extraordinary effort.
I had like 60 in a game. I had 59 in the game before that. So it wasn't like, oh God, he got hot one night and got 71. So it wasn't a big surprise to me. It was more or less when I did do it, I go like this, say, okay, well, it was going to happen.
He is the most trash-talkingest cat you ever want to see, man. He put the T in trash talk. He'd be in your ear like a pit bull all the time, man, like talking to you, up and down the floor.
If you get caught up in it, that's your problem.
He was a machine, the mean machine, as it turns out.
Again, Al Green having a great start to the game, has Pierce again for three more, and he makes it. Great basket, Darryl Pierce.
Darryl Pierce is one of the most entertaining and engaging characters I've ever met in this sport. And as a player, he was second to none in the position he played as a off-guard scorer. You know, he had range, he could take it to the hoop, and he was a great passer.
Yes, nice give and go. Oh, how about that for a pass from Pierce?
Then afterwards, his impersonations of pretty much everybody he played with, against everyone that coached him, he would have everyone in stitches. He's just a great character.
You know, the thing is, when he used to impersonate Gary Fox, man.
Running the ball, we're pumping it inside. We're pumping it inside.
He could be a true winner, but he's the most funniest guy off the court that you want to meet.
My whole thought process, and I used to believe this, so-and-so is a defensive specialist. It's because he can't shoot, mate. He can't shoot. And when you think about it, most of the defensive specialists couldn't score, but every team needs one.
Darryl was just such an effortless shooter. You know, it was all wrist. You look at someone like Brett Maher, who's a jump shooter, who gets his legs into it. You know, Darryl was you know, would need a, you know, what seemed like a millionth of a second to get that shot away. And once he got going, I mean, he was extraordinary.
Kicks it to Pierce, loves him out here. Oh, yeah.
Once Darryl got in the zone, there wasn't a better shooter in the NBL at that time.
It's Pierce fair dinkum. He could throw it out of the dressing room, Pierce, and it'd go in tonight.
You had to come and respect that. Then he could go off the drive and he could find a teammate. So he was more than just a scorer.
And a beautiful assist underneath the Mark Davis.
Mark Davis is one of the greatest players that ever lived.
Mark Davis was a superstar rebounder and just he came to work every day. He always left it on the court. In the 80s, he was a bona fide superstar.
And that would be one of the best slam dunks you'll ever see, Andrew Kay.
He was playing just our local competition, right? So when they say, oh, we got an NBL job for you, he's like, I didn't expect that, right?
My thing was rebounding. A lot of my points was actually created through the rebounding.
That's a lovely move by Peter Aloy, but what a great rebound by Mark Davis. And he jams it in with a slam dunk.
So I used to try to go and get mine off the glass, man. So after Darryl and all of them shoot it.
I was bringing Mark Davis and Bill Jones into the game.
So I used to do like this. It's like, Darryl got the ball in his hand. He's in position. I better go to the glass right now.
Darryl Pierce, the three-point attempt, short with it. Again, the rebound goes to Mark Davis. And again, the score goes to Mark Davis.
Yeah, that's me knowing my teammates. But he never used to miss that much.
I think the 36ers were very, very lucky. A star fell out of the sky for them with Mark Davis.
Peter Allo with plenty of space. It's a step shot.
In that first team, when the merger occurred, Peter Allo was named the captain. I think that was more to just keep everybody happy that he was someone everyone could identify with. Arguably one of the best defensive players of all time, certainly of his era.
Pete always, I suppose, had the job of taking the new imports coming into the league, the tough Americans. And that was always interesting to watch, that you've just got this guy coming into the country. He's got these big raps and he's wants to dunk everything, and he's coming up against an Australian white bloke.
Couldn't jump.
He'd cut through the key and he'd bloody snot you one. So that's where my anger problems occurred, because of Pete beating me up all the time.
There's a guy that's playing the perfect team role and helping his team win.
Comes into Bill Jones. Decides to go it alone and makes the basket, and the crowd goes wild.
Bill Jones was an athlete. 6'9", arms like a praying mantis. It was unbelievable.
Passes off inside to Jones. Whoa. And here is the slam dunk. Come on down, Bill Jones.
There's two centers, I would say, that was two of the best centers I played along with my whole time here in Adelaide. And that was Bill Jones and Paul Reese, all right? For two different reasons, all right? But I thought they played the center position the way a center is supposed to play.
You know, some of the shots he blocked down the stretch.
Tries to go all the way. What a fantastic reject, Bill Jones.
You know, you might look at the stat line at the end of the game and it might not say something extraordinary, but he had the knack of coming out with a big play.
He's like the quarterback. And as soon as you get beat or anything like that, you know Bill is somewhere to help me.
Inside Wackerson, rejected from Jones, and maybe the player of the night.
But as a center, I thought he actually played the center position as good as any center that we've ever had here.
Gives Mackay the ball. Bourques puts the shot up and makes 3 points. Lovely shot from Mike Mackay.
Mike Mackay was a very, very much a loose cannon in the early days. He was in the Darryl Pierce mould in that he was an outside shooter, but he had a lot more fireiness about his game than Darryl.
When he hit the floor with the Sixers, I was already prepared. I don't think the Sixers at that particular time were prepared for Michael.
I was probably a bit of a wild child and wasn't able to curb my emotions. I sort of played with my heart on my sleeve, and especially in those early days, I'd go out there and everyone called me Mad Max for a while, because I was a little bit crazy.
Mike had a fair amount of attitude in that time, and he had a big belief in his ability, and he had great ability.
That was my role. Come in, shoot, try and knock it down and make things happen.
To Mackay. Mike Mackay attempts the long shot and makes it.
Mackay goes for a three-pointer and gets it.
One time Mike said, well, am I shooting too much? I said, Mike, look, the basket's up there for that, so shoot at it.
Shoot the hell out the ball, man. You know, he's, he get going. Mike can hurt you.
Yeah, the 85 roster was excellent, and Ray Wood had been a championship starting guard with West Adelaide in 1982, so he could play the backup point position, and he could also play it off guard because he had nice range.
Ray Wood, that looks on target. Yes, it is.
He's a banker. He comes to work as a banker. He knows he's got to count his minutes, he's got to count his moments on the court, and he'll give you everything he has for the minutes he was there.
And David Spear was one of the guys who kept everybody honest, and a much underrated NBL player. When he got his opportunities, he too was valued. It's not like he did anything foolish on the floor.
I have it from David Spear, and it's you for 3 points.
It wasn't great talent, but he'll give you 110.
You know, back in those early days as well, you know, you had guys that still had jobs. And then we were, going to trainings and so forth. So,
you know, you train once a day, or you lift weights by yourself, and you'd have to race from work to get to training.
Leaving Myer at, 5:30 when I knocked off, and driving up Marion Road and changing in the car on the way at red lights to get to training by 6 o'clock.
I had a job here, me and the other import, Bill Jones. We had a job at the Adelaide Casino. We were both security. So Cats and Nuffs used to mess with us. We towered over everybody back then. But we had our uniforms that was very, very short that we couldn't fit in. So we looked a little bit like Urkel with the high pants on, trying to be security. So I don't think nobody took us seriously back there as security.
You know, we weren't highly paid athletes.
I think I was getting $50 a game for 3 years. That was my first contract.
Oh, bugger all. That makes you better. I think it cost me.
I could have easily been playing for a Happy Meal back then, man.
Prior to 85, when the 36ers were by themselves, they gave us $10 a winning game, paid at the end of the year.
And I thought I was like living large. I thought I was like
A big boy. I like, yeah, this is great, man. $200 a game. I come from a situation I wasn't getting nothing.
The person that made it happen was Ken Cole.
I think if you're lucky in life, maybe you'll come across one, if you're real lucky, two characters that are absolutely larger than life. And that's what Ken Cole was. He, in his day, back in the early 70s as a player, he was the premier player in Australia, certainly in 1971. He was the best player in his country, and if you're in any doubt, you only need to ask him.
When he came to town, he was the king of the town. You know, he'd pull up in his Lincoln and his boots and his hats and his fur coat.
I'll never forget those red shoes he used to wear.
It looked like they had a fish in the heel of it because it was see-through. He was so funny.
Ken would probably fit that boy like one of the good old boys coming in there like, there's a new sheriff in town, man, you know, and like bang, bang, you know. He was like that kind of cat, man.
He was out there. He was controversial. He was big time.
I do think that it's up to the coach to be presentable, a little flamboyant at times, and he's almost at times a cheerleader for the crowd. So I do think that we're in the entertainment business and we want to get people in, and I believe it's part of the game.
He wasn't a coach that would ever say to you, as a journalist asking him a question, he would never say, oh, we're going to take it 1 week at a time, or, you know, we're going to worry about this or that. He would say, we're going to beat that team and we're going to score a record. That's what he'd say. And you'd be like, oh, where's my typewriter? Where's my keyboard? Because this guy would always say something wonderful. And the truth about it was, he meant it.
One of the journalists asked Ken Cole, he said, oh, I understand whoever the coach was at that particular time, but they're going to hold you to 70-odd points. And Cole's response, quick as a bloody rat, he said, which half?
He was just the obvious choice in a time when we went from no crowds to big crowds. He was the showman. You know, he was his own walking marketing machine. He was great for South Australian basketball.
It was something extraordinary. You don't see coaches, you know, being the most popular person in a playing group.
And the players absolutely bought into him, and that was a big part of their success because they worshipped him as a coach.
He was still the best motivator of players I've ever seen.
You just feel like you're 15, 16 years old, man, and he used to bring that out week in and week out.
The Apollo Stadium was just a fantastic venue, which originally seated close to 4,000 people before they actually put seating in, when they were benches, so you could really jam-pack people in there.
The roar when we'd just run out to warm up was something extraordinary.
It was loud, it was rowdy, you know, you could feel the tension in the air. I thought it was very intimidating to a lot of our opponents, and I think during that time the Apollo Stadium could have easily been the sixth man for us.
When tickets went on sale for games, people would queue up. There would be queues 6, 7, 8 deep, all the way back from the start of the stadium, back into the side street, and back all the way to West Beach Road. It was an extraordinary. It had the crowd right on top of the players, virtually.
3,000 people scream, you know, in there like sardines.
Could just about be struck by sweat from people running past, and if you weren't careful, an errant ball would go flying past your left ear. So, like, you were part of it. The 36ers fans then really felt they were contributing.
Big games here at the Dome, where it's been extraordinarily loud, but I don't think I've ever heard something louder than a few of those Apollo moments.
Apollo was the beginning of the 36ers, you know, experiencing success. So, you know, you look back on it and think that way about it.
The biggest question that they faced on court was who would be their point guard, because on the one hand, coming from the Adelaide 36ers side was Darryl Pearce, one of the great scorers of all time.
Oh, that's a tremendous shot from Darryl Pearce.
And on the other hand was Al Green from West Adelaide, one of the great scorers of all time.
Al Green. Yes.
One of them has to be passing the ball a bit more, and that was more of an issue of working out who was best suited to do that.
Yeah, look, there wasn't hatred. Absolutely, I wouldn't say that. And I didn't feel that.
Hated him. Hated him at the beginning, because me and him was coming from two different boats, and they're trying to put us on the same boat, and we're sailing two different ways.
I can't remember ever saying hello to Al or shaking his hand, or we're never close. And I could never feel, I never felt that there was a situation where we didn't like each other. It just never happened in the early days.
Scotty wasn't a point guard. Mike McCarr wasn't a point guard. I was the closest thing they had to a point guard.
I mean, he's one of the greatest scorers in the history of the NBL. And for someone who's one of the greatest scorers in the NBL to then all of a sudden become a playmaking point guard, I mean, that's another credit. That's another credit to him.
But at the end of the day, after the 5 years that we played together, I'll take him to battle with me at any time. He's a true winner.
The team chemistry was pretty interesting because there were a lot of big egos that came into that particular group. Now, a lot of guys that had been stars and were used to being stars.
We had egos, we had healthy egos, and each one was always trying to beat the other one to show that they were the better basketball player. But there was never any malice or jealousy that came through on that, and that was the telling part.
Coming in together and how we felt about that, we came along very, very well.
And that group just gelled very quickly. In fact, far quicker than you might have anticipated, considering that they were arch rivals, you know, 12 months earlier, and now here they were playing together.
Pierce with the three-point try, and as the Iceman scores, Al Green absolutely showed Brett Flanagan the go-by. Green, clever work. But McCall gave the shot himself, and it's 2 points. 3 point shot from Al Green. Oh, it's a big reject there coming from Mark Davis.
We used to have games where we used to find a guy that was just red hot. And so if he's red hot and he's the guy that got the hot hand that night, you know, at the end of the day, we was all about the results, man, getting the results that we came for.
On to Green, they're playing with so much confidence. Al Green pulls it up and scores. But immediately a reply from Al Green for the 36ers. Al Green, big slam for two.
As they grew as a group, I mean, they were tremendously talented individuals, but as they grew as a group, they were so much fun to watch.
Pierce, he's done. And Mark Davis coming away with a big slam.
We were learning each other, and we were basically sometimes get to do our own thing.
Great play, Al Green. What a superb move by Al Green. He was just going to control the ball and let the defense get out of position.
But their fast breaking was tremendous. They were excellent to watch. Off the defensive boards, bang, one, two passes, lay up, dunk, something spectacular at the other end. That's what made them so much fun to watch.
Bateman underneath, rejected by Bill Jones. Bill Jones absolutely giving Jim Bateman the horrors tonight. Davis looked for this one.
Well, the crowd felt the story, the appreciation of that move by the 36ers.
And Pierce. Come away against McLeod and score off the window.
We had to get ourselves together, pull it back in, and say, look, this is the target we're aiming for, and if we want to get to a championship game, this is the way we're going to have to do it.
Beautiful assist.
He's had a struggle around the game with another 3 points.
4 seconds left for three-quarter time. Green with a three-point attempt and scores.
Yeah, well, halfway through 85, we brought in a young, skinny kid with hair over his ears called Scott Ninnis.
I got the gig and ended up playing about the last 13 games, I think it was. Yeah, at that stage, the 36ers were just everything. You know, to just the opportunity to be able to train with them was extraordinary.
Ball comes out, Scott Ninnis. Scott Ninnis scores his first basket in National Basketball League.
Yeah, I was a fan, and probably fair to say I was still a fan in 86, but I guess when you're on the end of you know, a couple of elbows from Al Green and Mike McKay on a regular basis, it sort of brings you back to earth a little bit.
Scotty can get up in those days, right? And he goes to dunk, and I just, you know, hit him in the chest, knocked him down, and stood over him and said, young man, don't you ever try to dunk on me.
You realise that the fan worship better be put to bed, otherwise you're going to die a slow, painful death, I reckon.
That 85 season, the 36ers finished way stronger than they had started. They were coming home with a wet sail. They finished up equal first with the Brisbane Bullets, but we're relegated to the second spot because in those days, and still now, head-to-head results between two teams determine who's going to take the higher spot on the table.
So after finishing second, we had to play Newcastle in the knockout semi-final.
I think it's going to be the most exciting night of basketball I've ever been involved in my life.
I can remember Ken Cole saying before the semi-final against Newcastle, we will get a record. We will score a record. I can distinctly remember him saying that.
We'll bury him.
We sold out at Apollo. In 3 hours, 4,000 tickets. That tells the story right then and there.
Al Green started strongly in that game and he just destroyed his defender. It was Ian Moushravili.
Some nights Al was unstoppable. It didn't matter what you did. You could have a hand in his face. You could hold onto his singlet. You could trip him. You could bump him. It didn't matter. He was going to score on you. And that particular semi-final, he was having a game like that. And Rabilia just, there was nothing he could do. And I'm pretty sure Al mentioned it to him maybe once, twice or 50 times that he was kicking his butt.
Al just wanted to let him know that then he couldn't guard me. And even though I'm playing a point, he still couldn't guard me. And it was money time.
In the end, Rabilia had fouled out and was a very frustrated, unhappy man. The thing about Darryl Pearce was not only was he a great shooter, but once he started to knock him down, he could knock him down prolifically. Like 23 points in a quarter, as he did against Newcastle in that second quarter, that was not really unusual for Darryl. Once he got on a roll and he got streaky, after halftime, they absolutely obliterated Newcastle. It was amazing stuff, and the fans rode every single point.
We won an all-time record for the semi-final. Let's go!
Kenneth Cole, of course, was right, as he predicted boldly, but supremely confidently before the game, that they would set a record. They won by a record margin at the time, 48 points. They scored 151 points in a KO semi-final where it was life and death. And this is why the players just believed him so emphatically, because he would say these things and they'd come true.
And that's the end of the ball game at Apollo. The 36ers have won the semi-final. It's been a success story in Adelaide this year for the Adelaide 36ers.
Well, during 85, it was pretty clear to me that the two top teams were ourselves and Brisbane.
They had a great team. I mean, come on, you got Leroy Loggins, man.
Oh, and there's the block from Loggins, and away they go. Loggins all the way.
When you ever played Brisbane back then, the first person you could think of, Leroy, man. We used to do everything to try to stop that guy. He was so wiry. I used to try to hit set screens on him to slow him down or whatever, but Leroy gets into that zone. So whenever you thought of Brisbane back then, you always thought of Leroy.
Movement. Oh, great fake Loggins for a jam. Spectacular jam. He came down very hard.
Then you had the little ball-headed guy, Cal Bruton, my best mate. Awesome player.
You had Larry Senstock, who was just a hard-ass, beat-you-down type player. Then you had the American Ronnie the Rat. You know, he could just ding him away from anywhere.
They had John Dodge. They had a real good team.
The 85 grand final, the Sixers have come in off this magnificent win in the semi-final. They're feeling great about themselves. Naturally, they started strongly. They were playing great early in the game. And then once it settled down, as that early heat goes off the game, then you've got those fans, then you've got the Brisbane Bullets talent, which was, they were laden with talent, and that they fought back.
We know there was a good team and they was going to make a run at us, but I guess it was all about, and Ken was talking to us about how he was going to sustain that run.
Three on two with a pull-up shot from Loggins, and he's on target. Senstock out for Loggins. He attempts the outside shot and Leroy's hot.
In the first half, we probably matched it with them and stayed in the game, but in the second half, every time they scored, every time we scored, they'd match it, and they just had all the answers.
You know, Leroy Loggins was the man that was looming as the problem for the 36ers.
Yes, he's put it away.
You could never contain Leroy for the entire game, and Leroy just went off.
Watch for Loggins. Yes!
Dear, oh dear.
It was bloody hard. I mean, Leroy is one hell of a player, and he always seems to be able to find a way to get free. For such a slight man, he is so strong, both of physique and also of mind, and he is a one tough customer to shut down.
Leroy is, he's a freak. I mean, you talk about the all-time top 10 players, he is second behind Andrew Gaze. There's no doubt about that.
Slam! Leroy Loggins.
He always seems to be the guy for Brisbane back then that used to make that big play, like it's when they needed it.
It was a pain in the ass.
Unbelievable shots, fadeaways, hand in the face. We did everything we could, I think, to stop that. But he was on fire.
Leroy Loggins was spot on that time.
Well, Al would sometimes struggle with his intensity, and he'd let his emotions spew out.
I mean, that was part of one of my problems in grand finals. I would think, worry about what the referee's calling bad calls on me, because I fouled out that game in Brisbane, and I threw the ball at Larry Senstock.
Al Green out with five fouls.
Two great emotional lifts right
and
in the row.
Throwing the ball there at Larry Senstock. He'll get a technical as well. Well, how vital will that be?
One of the things they did was they took away the direction Darryl Pearce wanted to go, which I know aggravated him at the time.
They were overplaying to the point where it was almost embarrassing. And part of that's my fault, because you've got to, if plan A is not working, you've got to work it out.
Once they got their tails up, it just got bad.
Audie Matthews gives the Bullets a 17-point break.
Yeah, it just got worse.
Another turnover. Everything going wrong for Adelaide. The wheels have definitely come off the Adelaide 36ers machine. Gee, Cal Bruton and the Brisbane bench are static here.
Even damage control was out of control. It was the Bullets by how much, and it was a sensational victory for them.
Oh, it is all over. Brisbane have won the final. Ken Cole predicted Adelaide would win this one by 20. But I can tell you right now that it's a 26-point win to the Brisbane Bullets.
But I think in the best of three, we would have beat them. But it wasn't that. So they basically won that one game.
You're down, you feel like you feel like crap.
It was disappointing that we'd had such a great season and then to sort of lose the way we did to that particular game. And that part was very annoying. It sort of really cut quite deep.
And some people were in tears. I was in tears. Mike McCarr was in tears because we're emotional.
It's shattering. I suppose it doesn't matter whether you're playing basketball or any sport. If you go through the regular season as well as we did, and you make the final series, and you're pretty confident, you think you've got a pretty good shot at it, and it doesn't pan out, mate, you're gutted.
The feeling of disappointment, knowing we're better than that, sat with us for a fair while.
We had a very sour taste in our mouth, and I think Ken wanted that.
Ken called, even him being sick at that time, he called everybody in the back of the bus, and he said, man, I'll never forget this. He said, look, dudes, you guys were awesome. We felt short by this one game, but know what? I have so much faith in you guys. I want this team to come back. It was hard for me because at that time I was looking at trying to run in the Commonwealth Games for Australia. And I'm sitting in the back of the bus going, okay, I'm going to commit to this now. I'm going to commit to this.
As a whole, I thought we had a very successful year, and it was something that we could have easily try to build on going into the next year.
He said, let's hug. And our dedication to next year is to kick everyone's behind. We're going to be the best team that had ever stepped on the court. That's what he said to us. I'll never forget it.
The 36ers could sit back after that and said, okay, that was our first season together. Let's see what's on the horizon.
Next year, we're going to make history.
So the winner of the NBL Rookie of the Year from the 36ers, Mike McKay.
Michael was only about 19, I think. Young boy, full of it, full of ability and full of... full of it. He's a good character and a really good athlete, terrific player, and he was Rookie of the Year, which is fantastic for him.
Mike McKay winning Rookie of the Year was interesting because his nickname at the time was Mad Max. Now, you don't get called Mad Max because you're a gentle, sweet person who's going to hand around cups of tea. The guy was crazy on the floor.
As we say now, you got 3-4 Hall of Famers on that team that you win the Rookie of the Year with, right? That's really, really hard. So. When we heard he won it, we said, yo, we take our hats off to you, young man. That's a great achievement. After we lost in 85, we said, Ken, there's a missing link here. We need to get a 6'7 swingman that can guard Leroy some, because Leroy killed us in that grand final, and Dwayne's there.
This would have been my second year with them, with the 36ers. And the first year I played, I played as an import.
Nelson in open space and 2 points.
The best part about it was that Dwayne and I had totally different defensive styles, and so it was very hard for the offense actually to get into a rhythm.
You gave him the opportunity. He's a scorer, believe me, but he sacrificed. So it was a good mix with that team. He was their addition to the program.
Nelson goes all the way, makes the 2 points, and has the foul called on Steve Greeny.
In 1985, Bill Jones had been an amazing pickup as a starting centre, but there had been a number of games where he'd been in foul trouble. Now, Ken Cole very wisely thought it was time to give him a leadership role, because the leadership would make him less inclined to maybe reach in on the low percentage fouls. It would also give the opportunity for the referees to talk to him as a captain and maybe treat him with a little more respect than what he had gotten in 1985.
I used to call Bill Dollar Bill. Dollar Bill, he's worth a dollar, he's worth our dollar bill. He was the most calmest guy you want to meet, but he was so focused. He was really focusing. that's when that was his time.
Yeah, as captain, you know, Bill made sure that he carried us in a lot of the games and made sure that in the clutch he got us over the line in a couple of big games.
Over the line goes Al Green, comes into Bill Jones, decides to go it alone and makes the basket and the crowd goes wild. The whistle goes, what a fantastic finish.
Now he's the captain, now he's taken that shot and now he's making that shot. You're happy to see the ball in his hands.
That tip dunk by Bill against Geelong is, to this day, is one of the great endings of any game of basketball I've been involved in or watched.
The ball's come out to Leslie, who'll give it to Davis for the three-pointer, and he's made it. 13 seconds, so Geelong in front, 119 to 118. The ball comes across to Pierce. He puts it up. He misses. Jones, oh, he got it. He's dunked it. The time is up. It's all over. The 36 is home by 1 point. Geelong has shattered. They'll probably never want to play a game of basketball again.
Dollar bill, here you go again.
Have a look at this in the replay.
When the shot went up, it came off the backboard and he just grabbed it and dunked it in.
Came off the rack and they threw it back through, man.
You forced us into overtime and now, goodbye, get out of our venue. That's what it said.
The crowd gives them a fantastic ovation.
Have you ever wanted to have one of Bill funniest moment?
Oh, we
got all went out. Bill fainted one night. And there's nothing funnier seeing a 7 foot faint. You know what I'm saying?
And the thing about it was a night that we invited some of our Australian players to hang out with the brothers, right? So they're all in a black club.
And the brothers are out there in their finery and what's up? And Bill had this like golf leather golf hat on. That was his fashion. That was his style at the time.
I don't know, for some reason, Bill had this big brown leather coat on. Now, we just finished the game, so you're heated up already.
And the next minute, bang, just fainted off.
You ever see the big 7 footer with his legs up in the air? and we looking at him like, we thought somebody came and hit him or something, right?
And he was pretty embarrassed, I think. So he got up and, I'm good, I'm bad, you know? And he was trying to be cool.
And we all busted out laughing. And Bill just put his head down and went like this. And he knew he was going to get it for the rest of his career with us.
It was actually after that Geelong game where they had won it in overtime and then with the Bill Jones dunk that Ken was summoned to the board to explain why the Sixers hadn't been quite as dominant as they had been expected to be.
They had a very, very good team. It wasn't like we just beat a team, a bunch of bums. No, they were very classy players.
At that stage, they were undefeated. I don't know how much more dominant you could be.
I think that I'm either likely to be somewhere else, that's doubtful, or I'm likely to be retired from the sport totally and survive as best I can work-wise wherever I can to look after my family.
It was things happening with Ken in the committee that was unheard of. I just was surprised.
And during the course of that season, there were even rumours that they had approached someone else interstate, Gary Fox, about maybe continuing on in 87. So Ken was very wary about how this was all playing out.
You can't put your wife through the sort of mental pain and pressures that have been exerted lately, and I'd hate to part company with the team and a lot of the nice people, I suppose, that have been good to me this year, but it's getting very much to that stage. It's just getting very much to the stage that I'm finding it hard to fight it myself.
I suppose the hurt from 85, burnt in us in 86.
The whole season was like determination. Because, you know, the Sixers were determined not to let that happen again.
We had no fear. We felt nobody can beat us.
Al Green goes to drive all the way, makes the basket and hits a foul. Green, underneath to Jones, the third dunk. Dunk, 2 points. Makes the shot. Wham up. Davis, slam dunk if he wants it. Oh. Darryl Pierce shoots from a long way out for a three-pointer.
Shot by Dupay, but a follow-up for Bill Jones with a big slam.
And as Gale Green goes, bang! Claim in the... Scott Minnis scores a three-pointer off the siren, the long pass down to Al Green, who lays it up.
Sleeve as Mike McKay just lays it up.
Slam dunk if he wants it.
What a lovely pass from Al Green.
Ken would say, speed kills, speed kills.
He throws a long pass to Al Green. Al Green finishing it off.
That particular era, the 36ers were always of the belief that they would win.
There it is,
for Ray Wood, 2,000 points in National Basketball League.
You know, confidence is an amazing thing, and I don't think there was ever any doubt in our minds that we were going to win the championship that year.
Lovely pass again from Davis to Jones.
They were the most athletic. They were the team that most teams feared. They almost had a psychological advantage before you even arrived because they were so talented.
Pierce again makes another three-pointer.
To go 24-2 in any competition, I mean, that's just smacking people. We had teams give up on us in that year, I can tell you. Guys are just happy for the game to win. Let's go and get a free drink and have a shower. It just, we smash people.
And it's the West End 36ers, 124, defeating the Perth Wildcats on 83. They've beaten the West Sydney West Stars 124-98.
You don't always play on a team where just about everybody on the team is confident that they can do well. And I'm talking about from the 1 through 10, confidence.
Late in the season, Ken had some, other than the fact that he was sort of at war with the 36ers management, he was also having some issues with his business and in his personal life, and he wasn't the healthiest individual going around. There was a road trip in a state where he decided that he would relieve some of his pain by smoking half of a marijuana cigarette, which was in a room where there were some team officials and a journalist from the Advertiser, not myself.
And I was invited back to the room that Don Shipway was sharing with Andrew Both from the Advertiser and one of the other, and then Peter Ali came around with us. So they asked me would I come to the room, so I did, and everybody was drinking beer and spirits and so forth, and I don't. And I asked, is it, you know, would anybody be offended if I smoked, I've got half a joint, if I finish this off, maybe it'll help me sleep tonight. I asked everybody, particularly Andrew Both, as he was one of the people that I didn't know.
And I was actually one of the players that walked into the room when it happened, and I think it was myself and Daryl, and in the room was Ken, Don Shipway, Jeff Cools, and Andrew Both, the Advertiser writer. Everything was a new experience for me that year, so seeing a head coach having a joint was, I didn't really know what was going on.
Someone's gunja, and sort of you look over and there was Ken, and I think Shippy was there, and Coolsey, but Andrew Both was in the room.
Let me say, Andrew wasn't a foe, he wasn't a friend, he was just a reporter, but, you know, he seemed to have a bit of an affection for the team.
Then I come back and hear and find that that Both has broken the story.
You know, in all honesty, I think I first found out through the media. Yeah, I think I first found out through the media. And, it was such a huge story.
Wow, you know, that was a major explosion for the team, which at that stage was travelling really, really well toward winning a championship. And suddenly, the coach was embroiled in a marijuana smoking controversy.
I can hear Al say, come on, man.
Ken had a sickness then. They said the doctor described it. He told us what happened.
As a player, you know, you just wait to see exactly what's the fallout.
Is it affecting your coaching on the court? And my belief, it didn't affect nothing.
It was done in the privacy of his own room, and that's probably where it should have stayed.
In his room, doing his own thing. Come on, come on. It was like, we're going to get you.
Yeah, I guess the disappointing thing in the whole thing was that Ken probably gave the club the excuse they were looking for.
But I don't think these people want me there at the end of the season. I think they would sooner have somebody else there.
Wait, man, we just want to play basketball. We're kicking butt. Why can't our two big brothers are fighting?
I have no doubt to this day that Andrew Both wouldn't have written that story by himself. He was made to write the story.
Let's keep it real. Let's keep it real. They wanted it to happen, right? Somebody wanted it to happen. I don't know who, and they wish came true.
There's been many an accusation that's been laid about it. I think at one stage there was accusations laid towards me, which was disappointing.
The 36ers came to myself, Mark Davis, Daryl Pierce and Peter Ali, and sat us down and said, look, this is our situation. We're going to suspend them. We're going to do this. What do y'all think about the whole scenario, whatever, whatever? We said, nah. We said, yo, look, we've been winning with them, and we want to win the last game with them.
For Christ's sake, who hasn't erred? You know, who hasn't made a mistake? And for what it was, we're not, you know, I think it's blown out all out of proportion.
At that particular point, what the board decided was that he would not be coaching, he would be sacked from the job, and Don Shipway, the assistant coach, they would offer him the opportunity to see out the season.
Don was an assistant coach, all right? So is that like it was very foreign? Everybody knew Don?
Yeah, he was in a situation where he didn't want to coach any more than, you know, probably the rest of us wanted someone else coaching.
It's the West End 36ers winning the tip in the white uniforms.
They opened the next game up, and I think, I'm pretty sure it was a design play. The very first game Don coached, the very first play, it was running and Bill Jones threw down a dunk.
Shearers, Billy Jones, slam dunks.
And we made a pledge to win this for Ken too. And when he wasn't there, we made a pledge. We was going to do it for him.
You have to remember that Ken was the king. He was King Cole, as in old King Cole. It rolled off the tongue, and he was the king of South Australia at that particular time. When they came around to the first game that Ken wasn't coaching, people came out and they were like, we're going to tear up our season ticket, and there were placards, there were signs. Now, there were people that were wearing handcuffs as though, you know, they've been in prison, and it was just, the reaction was just mind-boggling. With Don Shipway coaching the last couple of games, they still completed the regular season unbeaten at home, which hadn't been done before. They had not been beaten in Apollo, and they only lost two games on the road. Both of those games were on last-second buzzer beaters, so they were virtually just 2-3 seconds away from going 26-0 in that season. As it was, they went 24-2, which to this day stands as the all-time dominant mark of any team in any single year, and that's how they picked up the nickname of the Invincibles.
The thing is, the players did, quite a few players did speak up on Ken's behalf.
Well, Ken told us that this whole team where it is today. I mean, like Don said, we have a lot of talented players, but then it takes a very talented coach to be able to deal with talented players because you got so many different personalities that you have to deal with and make them work together.
And the players banded together, that's how close we were, and we had a meeting in the boardroom and said, well, Coley's not coaching, we don't play.
Whoever was in charge of that situation at the time, everybody, they were serious about not having him back.
We said that we, you know, we wanted him to coach us for the rest of the season.
The team banded together and said, we're just not going to play. If he's not coaching us, we're not going to play.
And they went away, they said, listen, we're not going to promise you nothing, we're going to walk away with it, and we'll talk about it.
They came back to us and said that they would allow him to coach for the rest of the season, but that was it.
I took my hat off to them because they had to swallow their pride. They tried to throw, I don't know who threw something out there and hope everybody would bite on it for him not even to be there to celebrate his moment because he's the one that made that happen.
The game is underway and this is the knockout semi-final. Fantastic reception given to Ken Cole here at the game, his first game back from suspension when he came into the stadium.
From the moment Ken Cole walked out for that semi-final, the eruption of emotion and support from the fans, you know, you swear the structure shook.
I felt sorry for Illawarra. Illawarra got caught in the crossfire. It was just like the guns were blasting, the emotions were high. It was like, yeah, daddy's back. Let's go kick some butt now, right?
No one was going to beat us that time. We could have played the Lakers, we would have won, you know, because our coach was back and he was back where he should have been.
But Darryl Pearce has shot that from so far out.
We played against them with absolutely no doubt that we were going to win that.
Green drives all the way, and then that's the perfect way to break it up. Comes to Mike Mackay. Will he go all the way? Yes, he does, and makes it. There goes Pearce all the way, and it drops. And another steal for the 36ers. In years gone by, the third quarter has quite often been their best. Darryl Pearce, a huge three-pointer.
At one stage against Illawarra, we were that far ahead. Ken just sat Bill Jones and Mark Davis, just rested them. It was good for me and some of the others. We got to shoot the ball more.
Again, Darryl Pearce, one pass in the basket.
So what, we don't have to go inside now, so we'll just put on a clinic from outside.
Oh, lovely shot from Darryl Pearce.
We're happy to have you back in the building. You know what I mean? And we just say that was our way to show how much we appreciated having him.
Now Green, the slam. Yes! And that's the first one we've seen tonight.
My goodness, I tell you, there was no one happier to hear the final siren than anybody associated with that Illawarra team. And they were just like, we have been beaten by the best team going around. And the best team, as I said, of any single year, there was no one like the 36ers of 1986. The NBA, which is the basketball league that most people look to as the best in the world, had this multiple final system for a long time. So it was the NBL thought, let's make that our model too. So we'll make the grand final best of three. Game one was in Brisbane, another massive crowd because this was the rivalry of the day, Adelaide, Brisbane. And Sixers started off great. Once again, that impetus from the semi-final, as it had been the case the previous year against Newcastle, they started strongly.
What an excellent pass from Davis. Top pass, straight down to Al Green.
Once the game settled down though, Brisbane started to fight back and it was Leroy again.
Loggins again, two more. Finds himself free, falling sideways and looking for air support and still went in. Yes, he finds himself position of having a shot. What a top rebound. Big pass. Oh! That would have to be the play of the game so far, Dave.
What a remarkable shot from Ronnie Radley.
I mean, unbelievable.
Davis on a fast break should smash this. Does.
I probably dunked it with one hand because that was the only way I could dunk back then. I was a prisoner of gravity back then, man.
There's Leroy Loggins with the ball. And there's another 2 points.
You always know Brisbane's going to come back at you. I guess the whole thing is that you can never put your guards down with Brisbane.
The ball comes to Leroy Loggins. Outside shot, 2 points. Down low to Mackay. Great 2 points.
Now, you're coming to a big-time game like that, and if you knock a couple down straight away, you think it's going to be a good night?
Three-pointer, way outside.
And he really can turn a game around, as we saw by that last three-pointer, and that one as well.
And Mackay has the shot and the 2 points. There's the ball, falls free for Mackay.
But in this particular game, it was still Leroy that was the major, major contributor and the major danger.
It's to Leroy. Oh, is that man magic?
He was what Andrew Gaze was years later as just the most dominant personality in the game.
Loggins again at the top of the key. Another shot, another 2 points.
Tall enough to warrant a big defender, but bigger defenders were usually thicker, so they couldn't go with his quickness.
Leroy's pretty confident he can take him, and there it is again.
If you put a smaller defender on him, he'd take you down into the post and dominate you with his size.
Leroy Loggins, hook shot. Oh, dear.
The next thing you know, all the work that you've done just goes straight down the tube, man. He was one of those kind of players, man.
But Adelaide had a star import of its own in Mark Davis, who just went toe-to-toe with Leroy Loggins with anything you can do, I can do better.
Great drive by Davis.
Leroy has the ball. The bucket has the ball. Finals basketball at its best, and you can see now why basketball has become such a great spectator sport in Australia. Two great points for Mark Davis. Loggins straight into the hands of Mark Davis, who just stuffs it through for two. Mark Davis has 33 points, 13 from 19, which is 68%.
But that didn't stop Leroy. In fact, at that point, it didn't look like anything could stop Leroy. Adelaide thought they had the answer that year, and as it would turn out, they did.
My greatest recollection of that game is Bill Jones jumping out in front of Leroy Loggins.
No! No, no, no!
That's a big call, and that's Leroy out of the game.
Bill Jones at 6'9", stepping in front of the best player in the game and being able to take a charge, which is his fifth foul, was the defining moment of that game and the biggest recollection I've got of probably that year and certainly that series.
Back to the action. There's 13 seconds left.
It still could go into overtime.
There's 8 seconds left.
Still could go into overtime this game.
And that's it.
It's overtime.
There's the shot. It's overtime. Overtime time. Can the Brisbane Bullets hold out the might of the Adelaide 36ers?
The overtime was still neck and neck. It's not as though Loggins' absence suddenly meant that Brisbane folded. This was a team deep with talent.
Radliff. Yes! Davis. Yes, inside to Al Green, who just rolls it in for two. Where to pass to? No one's moving. Bill Jones.
with the shot that drops.
It was really wide open, right pretty much to the last play where the 36ers had the lead and Brisbane had a possession.
Here we go now. They need to score within 4 seconds. The clock doesn't start until the ball is in play and they've blown it. A turnover.
And Ray Wood, the almost the forgotten third guard behind the spotlight that shone so brightly on Al Green and Darryl Pearce, Ray Wood made the steal that guaranteed Brisbane couldn't get a shot off to steal the victory and that Adelaide would be returning to Apollo Stadium where it was unbeaten with a 1-0 lead in the best of three game final.
Don't for 1 minute think that the Adelaide 36ers have got this final sewn up.
Arguably, if it had just been a single game grand final, then that one would probably be the one that people refer to as the greatest of all time, because not terribly many grand finals go to overtime.
The whole plan is to win, and so far when we get people back in our own backyard, well, we'll just try and nail it down if we can next Friday night. I think it's going to be a very interesting game.
Game two, the 36ers have come home, back to Apollo, which is their stronghold, where they haven't lost in the entire regular season, where they've gone 14-0, where they've now gone 15-0, having belted Illawarra.
Then we come back just like every other team, thinking that, okay, get the champagne, put it on ice, it's done. They're going to come here, they ain't going to do nothing. And they come there, and I could not believe it.
Reject, John Dodge! And it's 3-on-1, Bullock should score. Easy bucket, Ron Radford.
As Larry Senstock under a lot of pressure there, as Calvin Bruton shoots from outside, it's a three-pointer.
He certainly wouldn't shoot from that far, but this man would, Cal Bruton, and does it beautifully.
That was a big matchup between Al and Cal, I think, in that second game. And those two was kind of like going at it, talking trash to each other. It's hard to believe that they were friends, man, because, you know, the way those guys went at each other, it was like, yeah, we buddies after this thing is over with, man. We ain't got nothing to do with each other right now. It was all war.
Double spin, lovely pass to Pinarello. What a play!
Ball with the West End 36ers. It'll be Darryl Pearce makes it.
And when Darryl Pearce caught fire, that Iceman, boy oh boy, it was coming from everywhere. He hit 6 of 7 threes in that second quarter in a shooting display that you would think would have just buckled the bullets. They just, oh, we just can't handle that. Let's just go home. Let's just get out of here.
Darryl Pearce hits his fourth three-pointer.
And all of a sudden, the 36ers are back into the game. And that man, Darryl Pearce.
So the Sixers, 2 points down. It's an outside shot from Darryl Pearce is good. So for the first time, the 36ers hit the front.
Once he got going, you know, he just couldn't be stopped because he didn't need any time or space to get his shot away. You know, he never got blocked.
Pearcey in that moment, it was like the fans were going crazy. I think this thing is over.
As Darryl Pearce goes to his left again and hits another basket.
You know, that tended to ignite Cal Bruton. Now, Cal Bruton is as fierce a competitor as you can get. If you've got him on the same court as Al Green, best of friends off, worst of enemies on. And it was Cal's turn to try and turn this game around, and he did it. Didn't he do it?
Makes amends. The Black Pearl, first year in the Australian team this year, dribbling all around, gets right in, pops it up, makes it.
He hit some wicked, some tough shots against Al, playing him very, very tough, with a hand on the shot and all the rest of it, you know. But when a guy's feeling it, man, he's feeling it. Ain't nothing you can do besides do like this. All right, turn back and look and walk back down the court, say, geez, I better not let him even touch it next time.
He exerted his will over the game. They may have had a number of other great stars in that team, but at that moment, Cal was not going to let them go out of that building, having been swept 2-0 in the very first best of three series.
As Cal Bruton hits a lovely three-point shot.
Are you kidding? We're the Brisbane Bullets, we're the defending champions, we came in here to win. And that's precisely what they did, and they did it on the back of the shortest man on the floor.
Clay, that was one of those games where we thought we may have had it, you know, but Brisbane played really well.
Brisbane have walked into the third final playoff on Sunday with a 104-83 point victory.
And you look up in the ceiling and there was the netting holding back the balloons that as soon as the siren went, they could drop the balloons from the ceiling. There were people leaving the Apollo in tears who had become season ticket holders that year and had never seen the 36ers lose. And they couldn't believe it. They're going out like, what just happened?
The players would obviously hurt a lot right now.
Well, they should. You know, they let themselves down, they let the crowd down, they let everybody down. We beat ourselves with a real lousy game.
We were disappointed. We wanted to wrap it up in two and party hard that night, but it wasn't to be. So, you know, Coley, we booked into a motel.
I think we stayed in hotels. We went away from the families and all the rest of it. We were staying in a hotel here in Adelaide.
Depending on who you believe, it might have been to keep some people from going out during the week.
Well, here we go again from the Apollo Stadium for the third and final match between the West End 36ers and the Brisbane Bullets.
Game three rolled up on Sunday and a bit of a question mark has suddenly appeared over Al Green.
And everybody said, oh, Al's having a bad game. He can't play grand finals. They dogging me out. First person they're going to pick on is me, right? I'm like, okay, I wear it.
It was very important for Al Green to come out and play a very good game three. Now, they always introduce the players from under the stage at the Apollo, and they called him out in number order.
Ken called a team meeting and said, look, this is what I'm doing. Al, your number's number 15, but you're going to be the last person called out. Our season basically straight up relies on you. We got to feed off your motivation. We got to feed off your energy. We need a lot from you. Simple as that. So I'm saying, now you just threw me against the wall, just put all the guns at me. I become the firing the pin now. Bring it on.
They've gone to the numbers and they've gone past 15 and have not called out Al Green.
Where's Al? Where's Al? And I run out.
And the place goes crazy because they know. Everybody knows we want Al, we're wanting Al to play great. We're willing him to play great in this game.
He had steam coming from his ears.
And the first person I point out is my mate, Cal Bruton. I said, I'm gonna get you. I'm just almost in tears with so motivation. I want this, this is mine. And I'm looking at Cal, looking at me like, what is wrong with him, right?
It's a very subtle thing, but very important in the scheme of things. And suddenly when the game unfolds, you know we're in a real game. Al's in the game. Al's playing the game. He's distributing the ball. He's looking to score. He's a big part of the game.
That one is Al Green will put up from the three-point line. What a shot! The crowd love it. They've been waiting for a big game. Al Green in the fast break. Al Green will look for a foul if he can.
Cal comes on. As soon as he comes on, he goes to do his little quick little crossover. I step in front of him, a charge. When I fell up, I got up, yeah, and I'm just pumped.
It's called on Cal Green. The crowd love it. Green wouldn't like it.
You can just feel the atmosphere, the tension in the air. I think we truly was focused as a group from the time the ball was thrown up in that game.
Sixers are doing what the Bullets did on Friday night.
And a more focused group of players I've never experienced.
But it's Bill Jones from outside and they make another two baskets. That is the 36ers into offense. And Davis goes all the way and makes the basket. And it's a defensive foul.
Davis, the long pass to LA. He's got time to make it. Does. And the score counts. Yes, it does. It's half time.
For whatever reason, my leg just went stiff and I felt I was going to fall over. I was relieved when it went through.
Defensively, keep up and at it. Deny hard. Don't foul those shooters. They're not good enough to foul. Just go up in front and get to the board.
The defensive Sixers played in that quarter was exemplary and the sort of stuff you should put in a time capsule. Like they, apart from a couple of putbacks, etc., the only guy that was actually able to still keep scoring was Cal Bruton.
The Sangstock should make two. Rejected by Jones.
And I think Peter Ally did a pretty good job in that game. He sacrificed, everything he had to do a decent job on Leroy in that game, and I thought he did a great job.
Ball went up for shot and was bouncing on the ring sort of thing, and I was under the basket, and I didn't want to be there because that's where you get cuts and bruises. But I found myself, under the ring, and I saw Leroy just slowly coming in, for the rebound. So I attempted to sort of just block out, and as I felt him just touch my back, and it was a wafer touch, I was thrust forward over the baseline. So it was a bit of a stage. I did have a thespian side to my game.
Leroy is leaving. Leroy is out of the game. Taps Eddie Crouch, the ref on the bum, and says, see you next year.
Leroy is out of the game.
You're always quite happy to see the back of Leroy after those games, man, because he can make so many different things happen and he causes so many matchup problems.
You got to do whatever it takes to win that game, and if it try and you know, have a young white Australian kid giving him some and get under his skin, yeah, I'll take that.
But let's see if Brisbane come back again as they've done all year. Brute, gee, isn't he a fine player?
Cal went and thought, well, somebody's got to score, it may as well be me. Al Green wasn't about to let us lose, as he showed in the third game. Darryl Pearce wasn't going to let the 36ers lose. And then you had Mike Mackay and Dwayne Nelson. It was a team, now a star team, whereas the year before, they'd been put together, all these stars from two groups. Now it was the culmination, it was the finish, it was the cream.
They sold around a three-point shot from outside, and that could be the ball game. What a drive to the basket by Al Green. But Al Green is making it very hard for Brisbane now.
I was in another zone, dude. I was in a zone. I don't remember one thing, just remembering I was going to stop my man from scoring. And when I had to get mine, I was going to get mine.
Al Green from the foul line and buries another 2 points.
And everyone's hitting shots now because you can feel it. The championship is coming to Adelaide for the first time. It was just the Sixers attacking. It was playing Adelaide 36ers basketball as we'd come to know it over 2 years. That spectacular running, scoring, guys hitting shots, and just the confidence that they generated off each other and off Ken Cole standing on the sideline, shaking his fist with jubilation that no, we will not be beaten. I don't remember a lot of the specifics of who did the points going, but I do remember Al finished with 22 points in that game because he was the one that had to elevate. Everyone else was already playing at that level. He elevated, they got themselves a championship, and in that quarter they were just running away with it.
What a three-pointer! Gee, where's that one came from? Victoria!
And then when Ken started making those substitutions, I thought that was a time where it was, yeah, let's take let that deep breath out, man.
Ken Cole has done something that people hoped he would do. Scott Minnis, who hardly ever gets any court time and just trains 5 nights a week with the players. David Spear, same thing. And Ray Woody's brought them onto the court and said, you're very much a part of this team. Go out there and shoot some baskets, guys.
I think I played 33 seconds in the game three of the grand final, but yeah, it was just an amazing time. Dave Spear and I both got on with, 30-odd seconds ago. I'll never forgive Speary because he never passed me the ball. I was wide open in the corner and played 13 games, and all of a sudden I'm fluffing around like an idiot out there, not really knowing where to go and winning a championship.
No, that is it, ladies and gentlemen. Open your cans of West End because that is the ball game. The West End 36ers are Australian champions. There's the man, Ken Cole, in his last game as the 36ers coach, has led them to the national championship.
One of the embarrassments, and possibly something that the 36ers board should regret if they don't, is that at the end of that sensational game three, they didn't allow Ken the opportunity to address the crowd. I think they were fearful of what he might say in the light of the circumstances that led up, and which really just showed how much they misjudged the man and didn't really recognise that he was just as joyous as anyone else that they had completed the mission, their two-year mission. They had completed it, and he was recognised for that by being named the NBL's Coach of the Year as well. So it was really quite embarrassing, especially when the opportunity presented sometime later in Rundle Mall, where the 36ers were introduced to a crowd of shoppers and the place was absolutely packed. And then when Ken did get the microphone, he was gracious and very generous in his praise for the team and the group.
I've just got to thank everybody and do what's best for my family, move on to the next challenge. You know, life continues on and you find new challenges, and I've got to do what's right for my three children and my wife.
Just the way that Ken left, that we didn't want him to leave, he left, and it was a bad moment for basketball in South Australia.
Mate, we partied hard. We partied hard for probably a good couple of weeks, I reckon. I don't think I was home for a couple of weeks.
There were that many emotions that sort of went through my brain as far as relief that we sort of got through and won the whole lot.
You know, the thing that flashed back in my mind was us on that bus coming back from Brisbane Stadium, played that game when we committed. And we, you know, man, you go like, damn, we did it.
Winning a championship in your first season, you start to think that it's going to be very easy to do that, and it's going to happen every year. And
finally to win it as that group, you just couldn't help but hug everyone. I've given Coley a great big hug. I gave him a hug and actually kissed him on the neck, and it looked so wrong, but you know, I love the guy.
To just be a part of that journey with these cats, man, you know, it was a great feeling, and it was something that the people here in Adelaide, especially with the merging of the teams and all the rest, it was something that everybody wanted.
This was something that we knew we were capable of doing, and we have finally, you know, done it.
I got the same watch on that I've been wearing since 86. West End gave us watches. This means more to me than anything. I still wear it to today.
Yeah, 87 was interesting because you know, Graham Cubank came back into the group, and Peter Sexton came into the group. So it came at the expense of myself and David Spears. So I know having won the championship, you know, we had sort of hoped that that would kick us on, but we went back and played the majority of the year with the Adelaide Buffaloes.
Everybody was still, I think, situated to their contract. So, and I don't think we would have left anyway. You know what I mean? We say, well, give Gary Fox a go. Whoever they're going to bring in, let's give it a go. We got a good thing here. We can win with having a mediocre coach.
87 was an interesting year with Gary Fox coming in as coach, and it'd be fair to say that that was going to be a difficult gig no matter who got it.
Remember in sport how much pleasure it is to go in and beat a team on their own court.
New coach, Gary Fox, felt so sorry for him because he felt hated.
I didn't really feel sorry for him because he kicked me out of the team and put me down in the Buffaloes, but it was a difficult gig.
I mean, I was pretty hard on him because he'd taken the job of my coach.
Coley was a hard man to follow.
I think if Phil Jackson had come in after Ken Coley, he might have struggled with that team. Such was, the dominance that Coley had.
I mean, here I replace Ken Cole, right? And I've known Ken for 13 years before this, and I knew the ins and outs of Ken Cole and et cetera, et cetera. My wife really had never met the fella, right? And everybody kept comparing us, and she'd get little snide comments in the stands, and we'd get articles in the papers, et cetera. And it ends just as an example that she ended up literally not even wanting to hear the guy's name. I mean, she'd cringe, and you know, it's not right to put that kind of pressure on him.
It was a tough situation for Gary to come in, because of the relationship that the players did have with Ken.
Gary would always, not off the court, but on the court as a coach, he would normally start his sentences with a, hey. So that became the strain from the team. Like, you'd walk in to say hello to people, you go, hey, hey. And having an American accent, it was easy to imitate. I mean, Americans almost speak English.
Al, you've got Carpino, same job you did last time. Excellent job, stay with him all the time. We want a lot of pressure on the ball.
He was like a teacher. And so coming from a guy like Ken Cole, who was like a motivator, then you come into a guy, it's like it's coming from two different angles.
Because we sit on the plane, right? And we go to a game, and we like, me and Mark and all of us sitting together talking, and he comes out with a list. And he says, this is Steve, we're playing against Sydney Kings, and then this is the paperwork on Steve Carfino, the stats and all that. And this is what, you know, Bob, I got the list of like a school teacher. And me and him, we all going, what is he doing? We don't need no list. I know what to do against him. I don't care what he's done or whatever. I'll work it out when I get out there, and we're going to play it like that. And that's the way he was.
Gary had this thing that he thought sometimes my shot selection was a little bit a little bit erratic at times. And he came up with this system that he would call out red for no, or green and amber, that I could have a green light to shoot it. So okay, it was a passing joke that I'd be coming down the floor and I'd hear red, green, amber, and I'm like, what am I supposed to do? Just let me play.
You know, one of my funniest recollections was he was trying to bring the group closer together and trying to do anything he could. And after one training, he suggested that we have a group hug.
You know, Foxy brought the championship trophy out into the centre of Apollo floor. And
said that teams are coming into our house, they're coming to take our trophy, you got to treat it like it's your furniture, you don't let anyone in your house to take it.
Now you can imagine Al Green and Mark Davis and Darryl Pearce and Mike McKay all looking around at each other going, is this guy serious?
So there we are standing, having a group hug while he's having this little story, and I thought, mate, this is way too serious.
Mike McKay, who probably lovable rogue is probably a good description for him, looks to his left, looks to his right and says, you put your right foot in,
you put your left foot out,
put your right foot in and you shake it all about.
Didn't go down too well, but everyone else got a little bit of a joke about it.
I don't know that the hokey pokey was quite what Gary Fox was trying to get with that, but obviously that broke up the group hug.
You know, I told that story when I got to the Giants later in my career, and that's got to be 20 years ago, and to this day, a lot of my teammates don't believe the story ever happened. It couldn't happen.
Gordon now some 8 points, and Phil Jones goes down the other end and goes slam dunk. Destroyed them as Davis with a slam dunk.
And here's Dwayne Nielsen with a dunk.
B5, Ali looks for the shot, passes off inside to Jones. Whoa. And here is the slam dunk. Darryl Pearce comes off the screen. That's his favourite shot.
But Pearce doing good work. A long pass to Mike McKay. Two steps, bang, 2 points across to Davis. And that's lovely. As Al Green, great stuff to get the ball off Gaze. Will he slam it? You bet. 2 points. Inside to Ally. Twist, turn, 2 points. Foul. Great play, Peter Ally.
One of the more memorable games of 87 was when the Melbourne Tigers came to town. They had this prolific young scorer by the name of Andrew Gaze, who was at that time averaging 42 a game, which was an extraordinary amount.
And I'm pretty sure I volunteered to guard Andrew. I'll get him.
Darryl Pearce did everything right then. The shot from Gaze looks good.
Andrew was up and coming. He was an up and coming star. I don't know what the hell they were thinking putting Darryl on him.
Andrew Gaze, one-on-one. He's got Pearce to beat, and he'll beat him easy as he Andrew puts in 2 points.
Darryl did a great job because there's no way Andrew Gaze was going to get 42 that night. In fact, he went for 51.
Andrew Gaze puts up a three-point shot, and that's good.
But at the same time, we wind up winning the game, getting in, that took us to the top of the ladder.
Let's go, Darryl Pearce for a three-point attempt. Looks all right. It's a big three for Darryl. Here go the 36ers. McKay again. Wow. What a tap in our Green. It's one-on-one as Green spins up beautifully off the basket. Pass break. Davis the easiest 2 points. Andrew Green goes one way, then the other. Drops it into Davis and bucks it down.
87 was a season of milestones, if I remember correctly.
So that was the season that Ali cracked 2,000 points in the league, which was big time at the time.
Here he goes, up it goes, that's going to be it! 2,000 for his career. That last 2 points by Bill Jones was his 1,000th point in the NBL. It was great effort by Bill Jones.
And Darryl Pearce, a scorer, he hit his 3,000th point. But I think the most interesting stat from the year was that Mark Davis became the all-time leading rebounder in NBL history, and he was pulling down 19 rebounds a game. Now these days, if you're getting 10 rebounds a game or 12, you're a pretty good rebounder. He was just such an athlete, so strong, so powerful. 19 rebounds a game he was pulling down, it's a figure that boggles your mind. Also at the end of the 1986 season, Cal Bruton and Brian Curl, the coach of the Brisbane Bullets, had a fairly public falling out. Cal was let go and snapped up by the Perth Wildcats program, which for years had been an underachieving program. And Cal's immediate plan was he went in there and said, okay, over the past 2 years, probably the 36ers have been the most successful club. I've got to model a team on them to beat them. And that's what he did. He put together a lineup that would specifically beat the Adelaide 36ers, who were the reigning champs.
He did it. That's what he did with the James Crawford, with the Tiny Pender, with Mike Ellis. He put a team together that kind of like was our team.
Tiny Pender came in, and that was Perth's answer to Bill Jones. And James Crawford came in to the Wildcats, and that was their answer to Mark Davis.
You know, James made so many cats out of poster childs back then, man. You know, he was a dunker. The only thing I used to, when you ever used to play against Shane Crawford, I used to just say to myself, I'm just not going to get dunked on today, man, because that cat used to dunk on cats. There's a lot of people, man, he made out of poster childs, man.
He had Mike Ellis to match up with Darryl Pearce. He had himself to match up with me.
And on it went, the particular list, that the whole group was basically modeled to beat the 36ers. This was a great plan. I thought this was a great plan by Cowes, and I liked the way it looked in the pre-season. And so when the regular season rolled around and they had their first meeting, it was Adelaide who prevailed by 4 points.
There goes the long hop. It'll make 29. Bang, 2 points.
There it is.
The score counts, and the 36ers have taken this game. You could almost call it an upset because they weren't expected to win.
Because you got to remember, he's just putting a team together. We've been together.
So the Sixers have won the first meeting with Perth by 4 points. They're meeting him in the very next game.
We knew Cal is a competitor. Now, he had the two best forwards in the competition. Don't ever think James Crawford and Tiny Pender. Tiny was awesome. And Tiny learns off of his mistakes, as in him playing that situation the first time against them.
Pass to Pender. Oh, great pass, Cal Bruton.
And James just going to come out and play hard. And they learn from that first game.
Again, it goes down to the wire. Dwayne Nelson is the one who has the opportunity to hit the game winner.
He's in, puts the shot up, he's gonna miss it.
The ball goes in, out, and eventually it's a win to Perth. So now they're at 1-1, and Cal's thinking, okay, this thing is gonna work for us.
He was gonna make it work because he was trying to prove a point to Brisbane and to the lead, you know, because he's always fighting everybody, right? So, and it worked.
Adelaide seemed to have great games against Newcastle. Many records were set against Newcastle. So when the Falcons came into Apollo Stadium, everyone was always happy to see them because it was going to be a high-scoring, you know, all-in affair. And this was no exception. In this particular game, when they came in, the Sixers rattled on 148 points. Al Green had 40.
As Green spins up beautifully off the basket.
And Jerry Everett, who was a very exciting import for the Falcons, he threw down 47.
I remember in that game, Al Green and Jerry Everett were going at it. They were trash talking like I've never heard. And that was entertainment money right there, admission money, good value.
You know, they was talking trash and getting very, very personal with one another. And you thought it would end right there? Well, no, it didn't. It actually came back to the hotel, right? And these guys are about to mix. And we all hanging around in the parking lot, the team and all that. So the whole team got together in the parking lot and we put chairs around. We up here taking bets and all the rest of it, who actually was going to take out who.
We're in the bar, you know, after the game having some drinks. And I said, give me an orange juice. And Mark Davis and Bill Jones, I'm like, what you mean an orange juice? I said, man, I got to get ready for my fight. I got to get ready. They said, man, you got to be kidding me, right?
We wanted to show our support. We was taking bets who was actually going to win the fight. And Al got some votes and he some was better to get to Al. He's like, Al going to get dropped tonight.
Yo, they were going to lose their money. Then. That was going to be a night they were going to lose their money.
I think Jerry made the right decision not to turn up.
We wanted our money back.
Yeah.
At the end of the season, we ended up finishing top of the ladder, which put us against the Perth Wildcats in the semis.
The three teams that were really in the running were Adelaide, Brisbane and Perth. And who was going to play who in the semi-final was more than likely going to determine the champion. The other team that came through the semi-finals was Canberra, but my recollection is that Herb McEachin had a family bereavement and had gone back to the US and it had just disrupted Canberra, so they really weren't the team that was going to be a threat for the title as they may have been previously. If the 36ers were able to get them in the semi-final, they were going to go through to a grand final, and because Brisbane had the wood on Perth, Brisbane would have beaten Perth. Adelaide would have won another championship because they had Brisbane's number.
The first of the best of three semi-finals is underway.
But the way it fell, Adelaide got Perth in the semi-final, and Perth at that time had built that entire team around beating Adelaide.
Oh my God, we're going to be in for a rough night. I started off slow, and then, you know, the Iceman came to true form.
Darryl Pierce, oh, no. Talk about touch the side.
But there he goes again. One strong dude, and there's a man who's going to blow you apart unless you're right in his face.
That kind of settled us down and say, okay, we're on our game as well.
James Crawford, a little jump shot. It's good.
Pender at the three-point line. Good pass man. To Crawford. Oh. Down the
tip. Great work, the big man.
Mark was... he had the ball, somehow he tripped.
And oh, there's the ball in the Wildcats' hands.
It must have been a guard for us that time because he missed the layup.
Game's over, Adelaide by one, what a thriller.
Just took it and just tried to sprint it up the court to get it out of there. And we wound up winning.
Well, after winning game one on their court, you know, we thought, We got this series.
We come back. We got them. We got them.
Perth have to improve just ever so little to get home in this game and take it to a third and decide it.
Perth is a little bit rattled. Cal Bruton gets into it with Al Green. There's a bit of a, I think they're pretty sure there was a punch throw.
And a big punch from Cal Bruton, and he's going to be sent off. He has to be sent off for that. No, they're not going to send him off.
This is the playing coach. He's rattled. The team's rattled. The 36ers are moving away. And during the third quarter, they're 13 points up and within sight of their third grand final in 3 years. And suddenly James Crawford, the Alabama slammer, the man that was there to counter Mark Davis, he just goes to an entirely new level.
Crawford's going to have the foul called against him there. Makes a fantastic basket.
James Crawford went crazy on us.
Superb. There's JC. He's getting warmer now.
James just took it upon himself to take the game by the scruff of the neck. And you can only do so much. You know, he was just on fire and unbeatable.
Series. Crawford, heavy guarding from Ally. Off the glass. Super move, James Crawford.
Nobody could stop him. Nobody could stop him.
James Crawford, the jump shot. Here's the basket from Crawford.
He loaded up those Perth Wildcats on his shoulders and said, we're going to a third game.
Minute 26, Crawford goes, slam dunk.
Anyone who saw that game will remember the shot from the corner, the scoreboard end.
30 seconds to go. Perth have got the chance to score and win the game.
Got the ball with 2 or 3 seconds left, turned around, jump shot.
And he makes it. 3 seconds to go. Adelaide will lose this game. The Wildcats have won the game by 2 points.
In the moment he hit that shot, there was not a person in the Apollo that walked out of there thinking Adelaide was going to win that series. In that third game, Perth came on and just continued on from where they left off in the fourth quarter, and they were running away from Adelaide. It was going to be embarrassing.
They just came out and they got up 5-7 points by the end of that first quarter.
Oh, what a turnover. That's ridiculous.
It was all over, and then suddenly, out of the blue, Al Green decides, no, you know, we're still in this.
We didn't have the killer instinct, so I just basically said, well, let me just go it all to the win and just go out there and play as hard as I can.
And there's the sense that possibly we might be witnessing a miracle. Maybe there's a chance. Yeah, there wasn't.
When Ellis got the shot with probably 2-something minutes to go and hit the three, that was the dagger that just, I think we just took the air out of the ball.
A 10-point win to the Perth Wildcats.
It could not have been a happier man than Cal Bruton, because the plan had worked. He'd done the right thing, he'd brought in the right players, he had come up with the formula to beat the 36ers. On the other side of the draw, Brisbane had taken care of business and had beaten Canberra, so it was going to be a Perth-Brisbane grand final.
You know, me and Cal, we hugged, because we always do. And I said, yo, man, good luck, go get him. He said, Al, you don't know how bad I want them. Because don't forget, Cal had problems with everybody. And that was one of his biggest problems, the Brisbane, you know, like, he felt that he had to go up there and spank him.
As much as Brisbane would like to have played Adelaide in the final, I think playing Perth was much more to their pleasure. There was never any doubt Brisbane swept that series.
I just couldn't believe that we lost that series. We lost it.
Probably the ultimate irony of that whole situation, that he recruited to beat the champs, but he ended up getting beaten by the team that was the runner-up.
Loose ball. Davis, this will be a dunk. Oh, that is a powerful dunk, Mark Davis.
I used to think that Dr. Wern Lynn was the best player I've ever seen in Australia. I've changed my mind. I think Davis is a better player.
At least one positive was Mark Davis was named MVP of the league, which is fantastic for him.
Should smash this. Guys.
With the nucleus of guys we had, it just fitted him perfectly, so he wound up winning the MVP of the league, and it was well deserved.
That's the year I shared it with Leroy. I think I shared it with Leroy that year. And I guess being in such company, it felt good, but you can only get back to, I wish we would have done better as a group. You know, I guess when you win an individual award, it just totally reminds you of what you should have done or what could have happened if you could have done this as a team.
It was a great honor for him to win it in that manner for the 36ers, because like you said, no other 36ers has ever won it.
I believe it's collecting some dust at home. Yeah, it's collecting some dust at home. I got it in the cabinet, but And from time to time, I look at a lot of the things that we've been able to achieve as a team over the years, and you go back and you reminisce. I guess you reminisce on some of the funny times and some of the things that you experienced on at times.
In 1988, we had this tall, lanky kid come from the Institute of Sport, but originally from South Australia, by the name of Mark Brackey.
Reject from Brett King.
He was a 6'10" local kid with a magnificent mullet.
The best mullet in NBL history, that'd be fair to say.
Pretty ugly mullet.
His mullet was so funny. We always got a big St. Bernard head.
He was very raw when he came in. He obviously had talent. He was as big as he is now. 6'10" with that monster head of his, and you could see that he was going to be something special. But it did take a while.
What's up to Brad King?
I said, "What you doing tonight?" I said, "Yo, you want to go out? Because I'm up here working, so it's all good." So me and Mark go out. And Marky, before he gets in the car, he just guzzles the whole beer. I said, "Boy, you're going to fit in well with this program. You know that, right?" As we know in sports, injuries plays a big part. And we were no different in 88. You know, we had so many injuries through the course of the year. And, you know, it cost us a few games.
Any one of the major players in the group was out at some particular point, whether it was Darryl Pearce, whether it was Al Green, Mark Davis. The guys kept getting injured. I think Mike McKay also got injured along the way. And so the ability for that team to find an identity and really stay with that week in, week out, with a consistent first five, with a consistent substitution pattern, that never really evolved.
Now, anytime you've got an injury and you're sitting out, or you can't train, you don't go on the road, it's a little bit disappointing, but again, you want to get back and you want to play.
Yeah, I think Mark and Al are probably the only two players that didn't get injured. It allowed them, A, to play a lot, but also get a real intimate knowledge of how each other played.
We were lucky because we had, we have four brothers, as we say. We always tease our brothers, right? And we were close-knit. It was myself, Dwayne, Bill Jones, and Mark Davis. We were very, very close.
Davis pulls out. Oh, how's the pass from Green? Look at this. Bang, 2 points, and the crowd loves it.
We were like, thick as thieves, or whatever you want to call it, whatever. Batman and Robin.
Davis leads the fast break. Look at that, hand off to Green, back to Davis. Duncan, he wants to off the pass.
We had a great relationship.
More like Black Man and Robin.
Yeah, Black Man and Robin. Who was the black man? Who was Robin?
This is Pierce from a long way out. Darryl Pearce fires one up from a long way out, and down it goes. There's McKay again. He's got Scotty Ninnis. He's going to still make this. Hot bad pick. Stuffs it in, Davis. He's a nice pick. Scott Ninnis. He's got David Spear. There's the pass. Great pass.
There it is. The game's tied with a slam.
Ninnis for the dunk. Goes. The long pass. 2-on-1 to Adelaide. They should score. And Mark Davis. Super game. Davis is going to go. Bang! Whoa! Great play.
Mark Davis just jumped over him and dunked in his face.
When I started to go to the rack, I seen him coming, and I'm like, oh my God. I said, either he's going to catch this thing, man, or you just see what happens. But I mean, I was committed to going to the hole to dunk it. And I remember that one. And when I dunked it, I felt good because, like I said, that was JC, man. Yes. So, JC, if you're watching, I got you, man.
Gotcha. Scott Ninnis with a dunk. And it's all happening now for the Sixers. And up from David Spear for 3 points.
In one game, we were playing against the Brisbane Bullets. And it was, tick for tat. It was going down to the wire. And they basically had the last shot. And they came into the key. And Bill Jones said, "Not on my watch."
Late in the season, the Sixers played the Melbourne Tigers at Albert Park Stadium. Andrew Gaze, as he had been for most clubs throughout his career, was absolutely unstoppable in that game.
Get up.
Yeah, that was the call.
Good call.
Oh, no, Cooper. Andrew Hayes puts in a three-pointer.
And then when it came right down to it, when the game was on the line, there he was in the corner, sinking another three. A terrific shot.
Andrew, here he is, very outside the three-point line. Oh, he was off balance and under pressure and buried it. All net. 45 points. Look at this.
It just suggested that aura of invincibility that had surrounded them started to wane a little bit in 87, in 88. At that moment, it was gone. And they're just about on the verge of the finals when Canberra came back into town, where Phil Smythe, favourite son, had often struggled. Well, this was the day that all changed. Phil Smythe had an absolute blinder in front of the home crowd. It was almost like he had something to prove.
Certainly the first couple of years coming back, I found it really difficult because I'd come back and catch up with family and there are a lot of distractions. Once you realise what's causing you not to perform as well as you can, you start to remove yourself from those distractions. Then once that happened, obviously you start playing well.
And it was a week later that the Sixers would be playing a best of three, the start of a best of three semi-final series against the same Canberra Cannons. It was a tremendous time for him to play great in terms of sending a message, shooting, putting a shot across the bow of the 36ers. Newcastle is always an Adelaide favourite team to play. No one knows quite why. On this particular occasion in Newcastle, both Al Green and Darryl Pearce went particularly crazy offensively. Darryl went off for 48 points, which is still the club record single game score.
And that particular night, you know, was just, I reckon I could have just kicked it in and kicked it and would have gone in.
As a team, we sitting up here saying, you know, that's our go-to guy in the offense tonight, man. You know what I mean? So my job was trying to get screens and try to get this cat open, because I said, if he get open, the way he's shooting tonight, he's going to nail that bad boy.
Has Pearce again for three more, and he makes it. Great basket, Darryl Pearce. Just 5 seconds to go to quarter time, and a big three-pointer from Darryl Pearce.
Kicks it to Pearce. Loves him out here. Oh, yeah. Yes, he's hot.
When you get him the ball at the right time, at the right place, he will drill it.
Darryl Pearce really rubbing salt into the wounds.
It was probably one of the best performances I've been around a player in my whole time being here. He was shooting threes out of his butt that year, man. You know what I mean? I mean, it was a freak performance, man.
We tear this game to pieces. Pearce, gee whiz, he's a good shooter.
And then you hear guys on the bench going, he's got another one. And they're getting off, they're having fun.
There's Pearce fair dinkum. He could throw it out of the dressing room, Pearce, and it'd go in tonight.
He was feeling it so good that day. It didn't matter what the defense was doing, right? If he got it off, it was down.
It was 11 of 12 from the three-point line at one stage.
Darryl Pearce does it again. 11 three-pointers. He has 11 out of 12, we've just been told, as Darryl Pearce. Wow, 91% from outside the yellow line. That is freakish.
You know, one of the other things that game overshadows, with our Green had 35 or 36 as well. You know, one guy scoring 48, 49, another guy scoring 35, 36. I don't know I've ever seen two guys have such a dominant performance, and ours was overshadowed because of, you know, Darryl's freakish shooting ability.
This man Pearce, bang. Unbelievable.
The screen is set for Darryl Pearce. There he goes. Oh, there's 47.
I remember late in the game, 5-6 seconds to go, and I only need one basket to get 50.
There's Pearce waiting for the ball. Mark Davis has had the shot and landed it.
I wonder that I got pulled out the game for that, because the thing is, I know my job was to get him the ball. But I was open to.
I just, coach talked to me during the week and said you got to be more positive on offense, and perhaps I'm passing up too many shots, so I probably took it to the extreme tonight, and it just happened to flow for me.
At the end of it, we still wind up being the minor premier champions again, if I'm not mistaken.
She's packed to capacity. The crowd is really revved up to start with.
Well, game one against Canberra in the best of three finals was going to be in Canberra.
As Adelaide were in Adelaide, they were very dominant. We were the same in Canberra. Canberra's a tough place to come and play. The venue was a big open space compared to the smaller stadiums, and teams used to get a little bit lost in that open arena. So we were confident coming in.
We came out really, really strong in that game. We got up by 11 points.
Darryl Pearce to hit two in a row.
And then I just remember Tad Dufelmeyer.
Forced outside to Tad Dufelmeyer. The pull-up jumper, Dufelmeyer scores. Three-point bomb from Tad Dufelmeyer that puts a hole in the lead. McKinnon's coming back. Dufelmeyer for another three, and it makes it. McKinnon's on a roll here at the Palace.
Tad Dufelmeyer, they nicknamed the microwave, and the reason for that was pretty obvious. It's instant, and it's usually pretty successful.
Three-point bomb from Dufelmeyer, hits again.
The guards were eating us up alive, I remember that.
Setting the screen to try and get rid of Al Green, but he doesn't want it. Two-point shot there from Phil Smythe, Frank.
Yeah, look, sometimes you're in the zone when you play, aren't you? And it was one of those games for me where I was in the zone, everything I touched looked like it was magic. I couldn't miss a shot from outside.
Right before half-time, Phil pulls one out of his hat.
5 seconds to go to end the half. Three-point bomb to the side. There it goes. What a finish for the half.
You know, everything was just flowing for us. And, of course, that one went in and gave us huge momentum going into the change rooms at half time. So we were able to get up by 19 points at one stage. And, obviously, when you're up by that margin, you start to play a little bit looser. Adelaide was starting to tighten up.
I think maybe we're feeling the pressure a little bit. We start missing free throws. And, you know, once that starts happening, you know, you're doomed.
Suddenly it clicked. The 36ers said, no, we're not going to go quite that easily. And it all starts to come together. There's a bit of effervescence. There's a bit of breaking. There's a bit of running. There's a bit of ball movement. There's some shots being hit. And you look at the scoreboard and it's 2 points the difference.
The game appeared to be going like it was in slow motion.
On the turnaround, Mark Davis again, they score. 2 points the difference.
Pretty much at that moment, though, that was as good as it was going to get.
So I think Adelaide had to chase and work so hard to get back in the game, you could sense that they were running out of energy.
And that's the end of the ball game here at the Palace. The Canberra Unisys Cannon have won the first game in the best of three series.
Here in Adelaide for this second game in the best of three semi-final series.
As you might expect, Canberra feeling great. They've just been in this building a few weeks ago in terms of ending the regular season. Now they've won at home, they've come back in. They have no fear whatsoever. That dreaded Apollo Stadium where the Invincibles of 86 went 15-0 and won a championship, it's not a fortress anymore.
And the General fires one up from outside, it's good.
I'm feeling good about going to Adelaide now. I've eliminated those things that distracted me.
And there it goes, bang.
Defensively, let's take it up a gear and everything will flow out of that. In the second quarter, that's what happened.
Canberra comes out, hits one three-pointer, two three-pointers, three three-pointers.
Big basket, 3 points. Here goes the shot, bang, that's it.
They've got no respect at all. What's going on here? What's happened to the Adelaide 36ers?
So you could sense that the momentum had swung back our way.
Oh, what a basket, Phil Smythe.
Mark's hit some big screens, there were some bone jarers, and Darryl got over the top and hit a couple early. So then we said, we've got to try and tighten this up. We're in for a big game if we can't shut Darryl down.
Bang, up she goes.
We're able to shut them down at the offensive end, and then at our offensive end, we're able to execute some plays that were hurting them.
Phil Smythe on the 10-second shot, buries another 2 points.
And they were making threes, and we were making twos. And, you know, you do the math.
Fast break. Davis, we put this one away.
Suddenly, standing out on the 45, I saw Willie Simmons go to the basket and thought if I can just thread the pass through there to Willie, he can get it, he'll dunk it, then we'll get the momentum. That will finish Adelaide off.
This game looks like all over.
And it came down, next play missed, and then we were able to come out with a win.
Canberra in the grand final with a good win, a lovely strong win over the Adelaide 36ers.
Found the way to bundle it up and mess it up again.
To bow out again, I mean, you start to doubt yourself a little bit.
I think the thing with 87, 88, all through that period, you know, we always felt we were the best team, but we were never able to capitalise on it.
They can't win the finals, they can't, but if we were going like some teams didn't even make it. Hello.
The Invincibles were no longer invincible, and that probably happened early in 88 when we came and beat them at Apollo, that suddenly other teams realised that there were some cracks in the Invincible group of 86.
Not only did they win the series, but they went on and won the championship.
It helped having that belief that we were able to beat a team as talented as Adelaide, because we thought they were more talented than the Giants. So when you go into a game with the belief you can beat anyone, then normally that result follows. To then be the MVP of the series was a fantastic moment, and you know, those things mean a lot, that you're seen by your peers as being the best player in the most important game, most important series. It's a nice honour to get.
Phil was probably the best point guard that Australia's ever had.
After the semi-final series with the 36ers, it was prudent of me as a basketball reporter to ask Phil Smythe, who was coming out of contract, whether there was some chance at the end of that year he would come back to Adelaide, being out of contract. And at that stage, Phil certainly said he would be entertaining that as a concept. So that was a very nice story for me.
It was a chance. So the door had been opened, perhaps for the first time the discussions had started. We'd just won the championship. So when you win, it's really hard to shift a player.
They go back into Canberra and Phil gets asked, well, you know, what's happening, Phil, are you going to stay here? He says, yeah, of course I'm staying here. I mean, rumours to the contrary have been blown up, etc., etc. It took me a while to forgive him for that one, but I realised then that he's out of contract and it's always good to play one against the other. And there would be a time where he would become a 36er icon, but that was a long way off in the future yet. With the way 1988 ended, it was time that Gary Fox was able to actually now move some people on. He wanted to move Bill Jones out. It was time for Bill Jones to go. It was time for a new import. The talk was that they were going to bring in a former Los Angeles Lakers player, and his name was Orlando Phillips.
Orlando.
Oh my God, Orlando Phillips.
Well, he wore 00, and the rumor was that stood for uh-oh.
You know, we got this guy that's played for the Los Angeles Lakers, so here we go. We're going to, you know, we then find out not long after he arrived that he's recovering from a broken foot. You know, there's been an American from time to time who's come out on holidays in this country, and he was certainly one of them.
Came over here with great credentials. If he didn't show it on the court, he'll talk about it off the court.
Never forget, you know, Foxy was talking him up as being, you know, this you know, great player and great human being. And he said, he doesn't drink, he doesn't smoke, he doesn't screw around. He's just this amazing human being. In the first week he'd been here, the boys had seen him pissed out at the bar, smoking with two girls on either arm.
We're looking at, is this the same guy Gary was talking about? Because he fitted in perfect our program.
There's plenty of drama at Apollo, so it was still fun to watch the games, even though the 36ers weren't quite as successful as what we've been used to.
The game the year before, and what a great move! Scott Ninnis puts up two. Bradkey! And Mackay now has the ball. It's 3-on-2. Scott Ninnis will go all the way. Pace goes up and the crowd hit him 9-10. Inside to Davis, guarded by Crawford, who makes no attempt to defend. Over the top came Bradkey.
That those blowouts wasn't happening no more. They were really, really close, tight, fought games.
They have to double team the ball. There's the chance. Reed's got it. Scott Ninnis all the way to the basket. It's all over.
Close games were a bit of the order of the day because there was another one against Sydney where it came right down to the wire.
Davies for three. It's the Kings tie up this game here at the Kingdom.
This time it was Mike Mackay.
Mackay. The attempted intercept opens it up for him. It's all over in another nail biter.
So those 30 and 40 point wins just wasn't going to happen anymore. You know, I think we kind of realized that in our own minds, but we still soldier on to see can we get another one.
Another assist from Green as Scott Ninnis goes all the way to the basket.
Piers from long range, hits for three.
It's across to Mackay, puts the three pointer up. Time. Giddy working inside, swatted away. But Scott Ninnis with a three-pointer, down it goes.
Pierce finds Davis under the basket as easy as you like.
They lead by 10 and Davis makes an 8.
Al Green with the hook.
And Phillips comes away with the ball, goes back to the basket again, climbs over the top. Bradkey from the foul line. The goal! And that is Mark Davis, 1,800 rebounds in the National Basketball League, and what an effort that is.
I mean, whenever you get a tip dunk, the timer has to be perfect on it. You got to know where the ball is coming off at, and it has to come off in that sort of manner, because I can't hang up there too long, so you have to make everything come together. And that was one of those times where everything came together at the right time.
Al Green's got Mike Mackay, but goes into Davis, up and under and around. 2 points. 700 assists with this little handoff. There it is, wham.
You can start seeing the domination of the 36er core that we had was coming to an end. We played Melbourne Tigers.
What can you say about Andrew Gaze? And every time you played against him, you would rise I suppose, try and rise to the occasion.
Andrew got hot in the last quarter and Michael got hot, and there was a battle between both of them.
Coming down the floor, he stole the ball and laid it up.
Nobody's going to catch him.
I wasn't to be deterred by that.
There's the dish back to Mackay behind the three-point line. It goes down.
Oh, what a killer.
Again, you open, you shoot it. As Darryl always told me, the ring is not an ornament. It's there to be shot at.
It was about 8 seconds to go. Gaze took the ball to the rack, laid it in, won the game.
Gaze makes the layup. Oh, what a finish.
It was sort of that's the way that 89 was going to pan out. We didn't quite know whether the 36ers were going to be a dominant force anymore, but they were still going to be around the mark.
And then we made the playoffs for the last spot.
Well, in 1989, the Wildcats lost Scott Fenton, one of their teammates, in a tragic car accident after training. And I think with them going through that, they dedicated their season to Scott, and I think that just bonded them and galvanised them.
This was an absolutely critical game because with the format of the best of three, it was Adelaide had one game here and then two games in Perth. So if they could get this one, it was absolutely essential.
The first elimination playoff between the 36ers and the Perth Wildcats, game one in Adelaide.
We started out very sluggishly and found ourselves very quickly down by about 10 points.
Cal Bruton, James Crawford and Tiny Pinder, they were the ones that stepped up.
The three musketeers were having an awesome game.
Back to Crawford, see you later.
As the season had progressed, Orlando got himself into better shape.
Here's Phillips, two. Well, it's showtime for Orlando Phillips.
For him to come down and throw that down in a semi-final, game one of a semi-final series, it was a pretty big moment for the 36ers and for the fans who were sort of suddenly embracing the big O.
And I think Cal knew it was one of his last hurrahs, so he basically, you know, was ready to fire.
The unholy trinity suddenly pushed the lead out, and Perth's going into the final quarter with a 10-point advantage.
Luckily, we had something up our sleeve by the name of Mike Mackay.
Gary Fox was upset about last week. That'll drop for Adelaide. Mike Mackay's going to drop. Mackay for three. That's all right. Crowd here on tenterhooks, as I'm sure they are in the West. Mike
You know, that game in particular, I suppose, was a good one for me that, again, you're able to string a few baskets together.
Here's now to Mackay for the three-point shot. That's good.
Three after three after three. We were still down.
Wildcats could win it here.
I thought it was the right time to try to go for a steal, and I did.
Al Green on the steal to take on Morrison. And Al Green can level it up.
And the place was in pandemonium. It was like a shipwreck in there. There was just screaming going on.
Scores are tied.
It seemed like it was like 10,000 people there instead of 2.5.
And no one will forget. It comes down to the wire. Al's got an open jump shot.
Aaron knows it's a three-pointer. It's missed. Orlando could have been.
And Orlando, suddenly out of nowhere, Orlando, the missing import, has got the rebound, he's popped it back in, he's pretty happy, the crowd's pretty happy, they're yelling out, Orlando, finally we've got something to cheer about.
That was a big play because, to me, the way I look at it, if you win that first game, anything can happen in the second game.
Adelaide started game two like they had been given an opportunity, a lease of life with that victory.
We were on fire, we were up, you know, 23-11. And it looked like everything was going very, very well.
But it was not meant to be. Tiny Pinder suddenly elevated his game.
Pinder from outside three-point line. Oh,
you know, they chipped away, and they brought the lead back. You know, we said, oh, no, here we go again.
Say goodbye.
In the second half, it was a one-way street, and that street was headed straight for Perth.
James, Tiny, the whole team just got hot and just blew us out of the water.
Pinder with a shot. That's a long shot. 22 points. It was a very high shot. It just about went through the rafters.
And there was very little doubt at the end of game two that this was going to be a Perth series victory.
Yeah, after the game, a lot of the crowd holding up choke signs.
Oh, look, as a professional sportsman, you see the choke sign. There's no greater insult in the world, I think. Yeah, unfortunately, by that stage, it had become a little bit deserved as well.
Much to their credit, the 36ers came out for game three, and maybe those choke signs had some sort of effect on the players because they weren't about to go quietly.
And that game three really was a game of ups and downs. They came back, we came back, they came back,
And in the end, Perth just took a couple more than the 36ers did and got across the line by four.
We wanted to keep our season going, but it ended in Perth, so.
But it had been a very convincing performance by Adelaide, given the way they had capitulated in game two. They certainly turned around and said, yes, we have got a spine. They had a spine, they just didn't have quite enough talent to get over Perth.
Yeah, that last game of your season, when it's not winning a championship, is there's just an emptiness that you can't do anything about.
It's an empty feeling anytime you lose a series. You don't get a whole lot of good out of it, because your season has ended.
Gary Fox could see the writing on the wall. He had probably lost the support of the players, and at that particular point had lost the support of the board, and there was really no point in him continuing in the position.
I don't think he was destined to fail. I just think in the way that the sport progressed, it just wasn't for him.
Listen, basketball's a team sport. It's hard to say that one person is the problem. You know, it's a team sport.
He's been one of the better teaching coaches that we've had in this country, but the formula he had just did not work for the 36ers.
When you're able to look back on things and you look at some of these teams that beat us during this period, you look at those Canberra teams, you look at those Perth teams, you sort of go, well, perhaps we've been a little hard on ourselves to, you know, perhaps we weren't the best team.
You know, Adelaide's reign as one of the top clubs was probably under pressure.
We probably realised an era was coming to a close at that stage.
I think a lot of us weren't enjoying ourselves as much as what we should have, and not blaming anyone for that, but you know, chemistry doesn't always last.
I think it was all coming apart. It was all, you know, it was like, we were great, now we're not.
Still great to have arguments as to whether the 86 team was better than the 98 team.
Do I think the 1986 team is the best of all time? No doubt.
I think it'd have to go pretty damn close.
You know, everybody's going to say that their team was the best.
That's a silly question for anybody to ask.
Body always calls us the Invincibles, and I think with the record that we had.
How can you lose two games, one by one and one by two, not be the greatest team?
Until someone can do that and do it as well as we did it, go through the whole minor rounds and lose only two games and only lose both of them by only 2 points. If you think about it, we were only 6 points away from a perfect record.
Different time and place, man.
Pull out the tape of 86, pull out the tape of 88, 89, see the speed of the game, see the athletes, and one looks like it's in slow motion, the other one looks like it's going fast.
You're still going to have trouble handling an Al Green and Darryl Pearce, a young Mark Davis, but you know, they're sure as hell going to have a lot of trouble handling Brett Maher and Martin Catalini and David Stiff and Daniel Mee. So I won't sit on the fence. I'll say that I think the back-to-back teams are probably a little bit better than the 86. And wait for Al to punch me when he hears this.
I know Scotty was saying what he said as a joke, because Scotty, I know you're a smarter man than what you seem to be in that situation. Come on, dude, let's keep it real. 86 ruled.